You're listening to TalkTainmentRadio.com.
The views and opinions expressed are those of the host and guest and not necessarily those of TalkTainmentRadio.com, the management, the staff, or T&E World Network, LLC.
Point West with Bobby West, heard exclusively on TalkTainmentRadio.com. Radio, the way it should be heard. Point West.
Good morning and welcome to Point West, heard exclusively on TalkTainmentRadio.com. Yes, we are live. We got 1 hour today and we are live. Hope that you are all safe and protecting yourself from the pandemic. Myself and the Reverend here, we both have our masks. We're ready. But today's show, we're going to talk about a couple of things here, maybe all in one. But blacks who support Trump, and also with that, I lost my train of thought there, John. With that, Biden versus Trump, round one. Somebody gave that to me. I'm not going to say who, but I think it's the man behind the glass, Reverend Coates.
Lennon.
Yeah.
Lennon and still behind the glass.
Oh, like. Man. Okay. Anyway, listen, I did advertise this, so if you would like to call in, you can do so by calling 1-877-932-9766, or you can Gmail me at the numeral 7, Mr. Bobby, B-O-B-B-Y, at gmail.com. Now, I cannot promise you that those will be read today, but if you call in, we will certainly answer your call. And if you decide to Gmail me, I look down on it. If we have time, we will do that. Okay, Reverend Coates, there's been a lot of talk about blacks that support Trump. I had Dr. Randy Shorten, who was a Trump supporter. But in general, what does that mean? Black people who are supporters of Trump. What has he done? Or enlighten us as to that particular stance by some people in the so-called black community.
Well, thank you for that question, and thank you for having me on your show today, Mr. Bobby West. It's indeed an honor to be here. My name is Pastor John Coates. I'm the senior pastor of the Metropolitan Church of God in Christ. I'm the executive secretary of the Ohio West Ecclesiastical Jurisdiction of the Church of God in Christ. I'm president of the Interdenominational Ministerial Alliance of Columbus and Vicinity, and I sit as Religious Affairs Chair for the A. Philip Randolph Institute. Just to give you a little background about myself,
yes.
I've been a Republican for over 30 years. I started off in the political realm as a Democrat. As a Democrat, my very first campaign was to, as a child, working to see a black man who was a member of the Columbus City Council by the name of Dr. John Roseman run for mayor. And I remember going door to door for him, then later a family friend of ours, the legendary motivational speaker who was a radio DJ at the time, originally from Florida, but lived in Columbus by the name of Les Brown, Mamie Brown's little boy. Inspired me, and I went down to do a lot of volunteer work with him at the Ohio State House, and I spent a lot of time there, got a chance to meet people as a young teen, and that got me very interested in politics. I went on to be the state youth coordinator for Jesse Jackson in 1984, and then in 1988, when the Jackson campaign hit, I saw something happen that I just couldn't believe at all, and that was I saw how black people were treated. Jesse Jackson had successfully really taken over the Democratic National Committee.
Uh-huh.
And I watched form before my very eyes a group called the Democratic Leadership Caucus being steered and controlled by the governor of Arkansas and his wife, Bill, that's William Jefferson Clinton, and his lovely, demonically possessed wife, Hillary Clinton. They formed an opposition group to what Jesse Jackson had successfully set up. And when Bill Clinton was elected president, they took the lead, the head of the Democrat, the man that should have been the head of the Democratic National Committee, Mr. Ron Brown, and appointed him as Commerce Secretary. We all know what happened to Ron Brown. And if you don't, you know, Google it, investigate the death of Ron Brown. But I watched Bill Clinton take back over the party and use his magic suave over the black community, and they say silly things like him being the first black president or what have you. But after years of watching the black vote be taken advantage of, after years of watching games be played on us, and then the ultimate deception was the trick that they played on us with the first, one of the first biracial presidents of the United States by the name of Barack Obama. I know you say black, but okay, that's fine. And I have some biracial friends too that also go by black, but they sold us the symbolism of this black president over any degree of substance that could have been offered. So, you know, look, Obama never made a commitment to the black community. Mm-hmm. He made a commitment to the LGBTQ community, and it's a commitment that he kept. He made a commitment to the Latino community, and guess what? It's a commitment that he did not keep, because even when he had both houses of Congress working with him, he failed to deliver a full pathway, a full and clear pathway to citizenship for our brown brothers and sisters. It did not happen. Left them absolutely hanging. The dreamers were still dreaming when Obama left office. And then, not only that, but nothing of substance was delivered to the black community, just the symbolism of his black face. And I'm afraid that the day he raised his right hand to take the oath of office, that the black community pulled out our pillows and our sheets, took a I'm trying to think of the name of the sleeping medicine, and we settled down for a long winter nap that continued to last season after season after season, because they told us that our greatest accomplishment has been achieved. And I watched our community flow into less substance. We have gone to nothing.
So that those incidents, and you pointed out many, were the emphasis for you to affect change from one party to the another?
Well, first of all, it never was a good idea for all of black people to put all of our proverbial eggs into one basket.
Okay.
That's crazy.
Okay.
No other group of people do that. The Latinos don't even do it. The Asians don't do it. That all of us would become Democrats, that 90% of black people would become Democrats when we have a two-party system in America. So, you know, first of all, it's a good idea for black people to split our loyalties, or to split our political affiliations, mm-hmm. and join multiple political parties, but especially in the two main political parties that will and deal in our nation. There's a lot of black Democrats. There's not that many black Republicans. So what happened when Republicans get in office? We find ourselves out of the sphere of influence.
Okay.
So I became a Republican from the standpoint of saying that we ought to have representation on both sides of the party. Plus, I agree with a lot of the principles of the Republican Party.
Okay, so when you say that, by the way, 1-877-932-9766 is the number that you can call if you have a comment to make on so far what the Reverend John Coates has said. and we will be glad to take your call. You said, so this is what happened. Let's go back, for example. You said you saw the games that the Democratic Party was playing, and you did not like these games in multiple fronts. You said that you mentioned Ron Brown. Now, for those that don't know, Ron Brown supposedly or allegedly died in a plane crash. Is that your knowledge, Reverend?
Yes,
Coach?
A plane crash of business, and he had business leaders on the plane with them as they was flying to Europe, and he was plane crashed. But when his body was found,
yes,
he was found with a piece of shrapnel in his head.
Would that shrapnel be a bullet?
Well, I don't know.
Okay.
I didn't place my hand, and if they would have invited me, I would have examined.
Okay. So, are you suggesting that because shrapnel was in his head, and can I assume that those others who were on the plane did not have shrapnel in their head?
I don't know, but the reality, they all were dead.
They all
were dead. And Ron Brown, who was Jesse Jackson's convention floor manager, Ron Brown, who had successfully helped Jesse Jackson to take over the Democratic National Committee and convention, Ron Brown, that had a very influential role within the Bill Clinton administration, was now dead.
Okay.
Under mysterious circumstances.
Mysterious, that's what I was getting at. The circumstances seem mysterious. Would you say that, you didn't say this, but would you could say that Vince Foster was also, could be considered in that?
Well, with the Clintons, the list is long.
Okay.
The list is long, and Vince Foster very well may be on that list also.
Okay. All righty. Okay. Now, you mentioned Barack Obama that did not do anything for the black community, and I have heard that many, many times, and from very, very many people that have said that he was not very much in support of the so-called black agenda. You mentioned something about him allegedly, that wasn't your word, allegedly, but being the first black president of the United States. But when I looked under Fukum and Bine, one of the many sources, I understand that he was actually the eighth black president of the United States. There were seven others before him, John Hanson being the first, who, by the way, is on the $2 bill.
And that's before the that's before our present constitution.
Right.
It was under the present, that the former
Congress,
right. But those other individuals, Mr. J. Rogers also talks about the first black presidents as well. But these men did not claim to be black. Barack Obama talked about himself being black and identifying as a black man. And one of the games, I talked about games and tricks. One of the games that was played on the black community is they play this game on the first black. That I'm talking about the phraseology.
Okay.
They play the game on let's make history in electing the first black. And I don't care if it's the first black president or the first black county commissioner, the first black president of city council, the first black mayor, the first black governor. And then once these individuals enter into office, especially if they're Democrat, when they enter into office, they say, well, I'm not here to enact any type of black agenda. I'm president of all of America. I'm county commissioner over all of the county. I'm governor over all of the state. I have the entire people of my geographical area, whatever office I was elected to represent. So that's therefore telling black people that I have nothing for you. But other races of people, when they're elected to office, they don't do that to their core constituency. They don't forget them. They don't negate them, especially after tricking them and manipulating them by telling them that, oh, elect me because you're going to make history by doing so.
Yes. Okay. Let me do this. TalkTainmentRadio.com is a 24/7 no charge worldwide broadcasting facility with hosts delivering on various topics such as news and lifestyle, sports, law, health, wellness, religion, and politics. Now, all you have to do is go to the TalkTainmentRadio.com homepage and just list, look under programs, you'll see one, Wiggins World of Wellness, you'll see that there. You'll see This is Libby, and All in Our Family with host S. Yolanda Robinson. Again, all these shows are exclusive to TalkTainmentRadio.com, and just go there, click on programs, and you are there. That's from TalkTainmentRadio.com, radio the way it should be heard. My name is Mr. Bobby. The show is Point West, and our guest today is John Coates, and he's talking about, as you heard, giving a little history as to why he changed from being a Democrat to a Republican. And what we want to get into now is blacks that support Trump. Now, Reverend Coates, you've heard this, and then you said that the Democrats play games. Are they the only ones that play games? In other words, do the Republicans play games?
No, the politics is a process of leveraging, and it's a process of a lot of propaganda on all sides.
Well, now, what do you mean by that? To the lay guy that's out there, or lay person?
Well, let me give you a good definition for politics, and brothers and sisters who are listening, you can use this without quoting me.
Okay.
Politics is the control or the influence over limited resources. It's the control or influence over limited resources. So I have $10, but yet there's 100 people. Okay, who gets what part of that $10? It's the control over that money, or it's the influence over that money, or whatever that resource is. And politics is then, by that definition, is played within your home, is played within your school, is played within your workplace, and certainly within government as well.
Okay. So being that game is played, then how can black people take advantage of it? Or more importantly, what has Trump did to gain the support of black people?
Well, let's talk about Donald Trump a little bit. And the emergence of Donald Trump, an American businessman who grew up on the, what they call it, the outer boroughs. When you talk about New York City, you're really making reference to its main hub called Manhattan.
Yes.
And then everything outside of Manhattan is viewed as the outer boroughs. So Donald Trump grew up on the outer boroughs. Father, of course, was in real estate and construction, and Donald Trump made his name by taking a small investment by his father, and then started to buy property and manage property within the island of Manhattan. Now, in the course of his business career, he had formulated and has made great relationships with a number of black people, many of which who you know and may not have thought that the current president of the United States had close relationships with, i.e. Jesse Lewis Jackson, i.e. the Reverend Al Sharpton, i.e. and the list goes on and on throughout the entertainment industry. In fact, I remember that the first winner of the Apprentice reality show was a young black man. So Trump has relationships within the black community. But what we see in his emergence and deciding to run for president, we see that not necessarily a Democrat or a Republican divide, but there's some type of other power struggle that began to take place.
Uh-huh.
And I believe it's the power struggle that where Donald Trump and his backers begin to make a move on the on those that have been really controlling America for 200 years in many parts of the world, that there was a coup on the palace, and Trump was the front man. So as he began to address common sense issues as a businessman presidential candidate, common sense issues such as American manufacturing. You know, asking the question, why doesn't America produce the items that Americans consume? You know, that's a great question. We talk about a medication. Why is a great portion of the medicines that your doctors prescribe to you are manufactured in China? What is America doing buying steel to build buildings with, to build structures with, roads? Why are we purchasing steel from other nations? In fact, I live in the state of Ohio, and there's a whole portion of my state that is a part of a part of the country called the Rust Belt. And the reason why they call it the Rust Belt is because these areas had booming manufacturing centers. They made steel, and now they no longer make steel, and the area has rusted out, and the areas have died out. So when Donald Trump addressed these type of issues, it attracts not only Republicans, but it attracts many Democrats that live in these areas and have suffered from Americans' manufacturing base being outsourced or outright moved to other countries like China, like Mexico, like wherever else American companies decided to move to pay workers less money.
Okay. With that being said, some of the positive things that he's done. What about the issue? Since he was a real estate developer, what about the incident? And maybe you can speak to this or not, but the Central Park Five, or his housing projects, where he had some alleged discriminatory practices against black people. A lot of the businesses that he did have were failed businesses. And then certain comments that he's made about certain nations that he called asshole nations. What do you have to say about all of that?
Well, let's start from your last example, and then work our way back.
Okay.
He made a comment about certain nations, calling them S nations.
Yes.
And for any of us who have taken the time or have had the privilege, I guess, if you will, to travel the world, there are some things that you see in some countries where you're wondering what in the world is going on here. And especially to travel to poor nations, you see that there's such a large economic divide. The country may be rich, but there might be a lot of money in that country, but that money isn't flowing down to the poor people, or even those nations are absent a middle class. And what you notice immediately in those countries is that they have very poor infrastructure, meaning that the roads are raggedy. And what really stands out, if you have to spend a night in those countries, is that the sanitation systems are poor.
Okay.
And that's in developing African nations, or in some places that you thought were developed well, but yet really aren't. A couple of years ago, I went on a tour across Europe, and I was surprised at the restroom facilities. Mm-hmm. I went to one of the most beautiful islands in the world, of Santorini, Greece. And as beautiful as the island was, as blue as the water was, and as beautiful as the beach was, as delicious as the food was, when you go to the bathroom, there's a little canister, a little can next to the toilet, and they say, please deposit your wiping paper, your toilet tissue, into the can, okay? Because the sanitation systems can't take the flushing of even light toilet paper with your human waste on it through their sanitation
system.
This is in Greece, and actually throughout Europe.
Okay.
And you find the same thing throughout Europe. So I'm in this beautiful, island, and what I smell is the stench of human waste, along with the moisture of the Asiatic Sea, and it stinks. So when the president made that description, I said, oh, I even know how that smells like.
Okay. But he didn't refer to, let's say, Greece or the European nations as SO nations. He seemed to indicate that they were nations of people who seem to be of African descendancy.
And my question would be, have you been to Africa? Have you been to Africa? Have you been to Nigeria, with a nation that has several of the world's richest men on it, a nation that is minerally rich, a nation that is an oil oil nation. It's an oil nation.
Is that what that you would ask
that,
him?
Well, it is an oil nation. It's an oil nation. We know that it's an oil nation. So when you go there, what you see is filth. What you see is squalor. And in fact, I've heard many people, of course, not use the King's language, or maybe the King does use this language, describe it as an S nation, an S whole nation, or even worse names because of the condition that those nations are in, and especially in comparison to the money that exists in those nations.
Okay, well, okay, we got a few minutes in this segment, a minute or two in this segment. What about addressing the Central Park 5 issue?
Well, the president was a resident of New York. The accusation was made against these gentlemen, and he expressed his opinion about. He expressed his opinion about it. He expressed his opinion at that time about what he saw, what happened to these gentlemen, what was absolutely unfortunate. It was sad. It's a reflection of many of the problems that continue to exist within our criminal justice system. Mm-hmm. But he was a voice in the city. He issued his expression. But people ask me about what position did he take about the Central Park Five, but yet don't want to talk about what position did he take about the murder of Jennifer Hudson's family. When her family was murdered, and they didn't know who was responsible for the murder, and they didn't know if she was going to be next. Donald Trump reached out to her and protected her and housed her and her family and wrapped his security around them in order to protect them. And there's countless stories like that as well. So as we live, we grow. All of our words aren't perfect. All of our opinions aren't perfect. All of our perspectives aren't necessarily refined or perfect, but we grow and we develop. Of course, but only for somebody else to throw it back up in our face later. But that's the price of public life.
Would that also be for his alleged discriminatory practices for the apartments buildings that he held against held in New York City?
And you said alleged. Yeah. You said alleged. You know, and any of you that have owned rental property before understands the difficulty in actually managing rental property, especially multiple units of rental property. You own the property in order to make money, even though you have an obligation to maintain those properties and also to perform fair practices. And sometimes people are on top of it, sometimes they're not. Sometimes the money's there to do what you're supposed to do, sometimes it's not. But you said it perfectly. It's an alleged. Yes.
Okay, I'll tell you what we're going to do here. How about this? TalkTainmentRadio.com. We go where you go. All you have to do is just simply download the TalkTainmentRadio.com app to your cell or to your tablet, and there are podcasts that are available. That's radio the way it should be heard. Stay right there. We're going to talk about hydroxychloroquine, maybe even the Nephilim, all that and more coming up next here on Point West, exclusively on TalkTainmentRadio.com. Okay, all right, okay, excuse me, man. I was just looking at my clock. Okay, well, then we'll just go ahead on then. All righty. Doctor, I almost called you. Are you a doctor yet?
Well, you know, all of us good bootleg preachers have at least one or two honorary doctors. So, so technically, I do have a doctorate, but it is not an earned doctorate. I only have an earned master's.
Okay, so I can call you doctor, okay. Okay. Well, anyway, Reverend Coates, I did hear the president mention something about hydroxychloroquine. As a matter of fact, he said that he had taken it during a two-week period. He mentioned that it was one of the things that could cure COVID-19 and all this, and even what is that, disinfectant spray, where that some of the medical people had indicated that those were not accurate statements on that. What say you on that, when he apparently has not taken the advice of some of his medical professionals?
Poor Donald Trump. You know, let me say this from the jump.
Okay.
Is that I believe that the virus is real. Okay.
Yeah.
The COVID-19 is real, and I certainly advocate that African Americans, and particularly that we do whatever we need to do in order to protect ourselves from this virus, and we are more susceptible to contracting this virus.
Why do you
and
think that is?
We are more susceptible because of the to use the language that the that the social health people are using.
Okay.
Is that we have comorbidities and multiple underlying conditions because of the social determinants.
Okay.
Right. But we've been dying from some of the same stuff: heart disease, liver disease, high blood pressure, diabetes type 1 and type 2, and a stroke, whatever. We have the same list, and what happens is that not only do we have one condition, but we have several conditions that are stacked on top of each other.
Would that be due to dietary?
It's due to a multiplicity of things, including the diets that are imposed on us, so-called culturally, as well as the diets we choose to take. You know, Kanye West said that slavery is a choice, and I need to tell somebody that type 2 diabetes is a choice as well.
Okay.
but then you realize real quick how addictive sugar is, and they say that sugar is more addictive than cocaine is, and that's why they put it in all of your food. But because of our underlying conditions, our immune systems are weaker. Okay. Because of the lack of exercise and the obesity, and because of the negative and the nasty things that we continue to ingest and digest into our systems, it makes us less likely to be able to fight off COVID-19 or to fight off the regular flu that still kills more people than COVID-19.
I mean, hydroxychloroquine has been around for, 50 or 60 years?
Yes.
And I do believe that it was used to treat malaria, if I'm correct?
Yes.
Okay. He has taken this now.
And Viagra was used to treat something other than what it's used for as well.
Oh.
So it was. I mean, the aspirin, baby aspirin, is used as a blood thinner. You know, there's medicines that have multiple uses.
Okay.
And hydroxychloroquine, I think, is an effective medication, not just because it's proven to work, but hydroxychloroquine is effective because of its low cost. Because of its low cost, 30-day supply would cost somewhere around $30. So thank God that during the course of this pandemic, especially in the early days, that Donald Trump kept the microphone in his face. He stayed before the microphone to provide a counter argument to the American people, because the professionals, Dr. Fauci and his staff and whoever their investors are as well,
Bill Gates, they
told us that our only way out of this was through vaccine. That vaccine was our only deliverance. That we're supposed to be waiting around to be injected with the disease is our only way out of it. President Trump said, no, let's look at treatment. If people are dying from this, let's look at effective treatment for this disease.
Even
right
if
now,
that treatment was disinfectant?
No. What he was making an argument about, and this is how things are taken out of context.
Uh-huh.
Donald Trump can't say anything without them taking a soundbite out of it and taking his statements out of context.
Okay, correct.
He says that if you are infected with something, you why can't you then be disinfected? So if a surface is infected with the virus, then you put a disinfectant on it in order to disinfect that surface.
Mm-hmm.
So why can't the same thing be in play within our system? Is there something that the human body can be given as to help disinfect whatever the infection is? Isn't that what penicillin is? Isn't that what other forms of antibiotics are? Isn't that what other drugs do, that they target and it kills the disease. But if there's an infection, then he was asking the questions. He's arguing out loud. He's trying to logically make an argument to the American people that there should be treatment, multiple forms of treatment available for this flu, than just getting waiting for a antivirus to be developed and then forced upon all Americans to take.
Mm-hmm. So okay, now let's go with this. I believe it was yesterday, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but there was a lady, and I don't know her name. She was a black woman, mm-hmm. that indicated something about some alien technology, DNA, to get together and produce this vaccine that would help cure that. Now, she mentioned this, and that these were Nephilim, and I know that you know about them and what happened. A lot of people don't know, and the media has been, they just honed in on the alien part. But what do you know about the Nephilim and how it's related to what this woman was saying?
From a spiritual standpoint,
yes.
In America, we are only allowed to speak of certain things from a spiritual standpoint.
Yes.
We can talk about God. They still allow us to talk about God, even though there's people that want to eliminate God from our conversation.
That's right. That's right.
We can talk about being in whatever context. We can talk about the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. I'm a Pentecostal, okay? We can even talk about speaking in tongues, you know, even though I don't think producers of this program will want me to speak in tongues today.
Yeah. Okay.
we can talk about angels.
Yes.
We can talk about angels, but we can't talk about other things. Larry King told me once that the highest rated shows that he had on his television program had to deal with aliens, had to deal with UFO phenomena. So there's a lot of Americans, not to mention people around the world, that's interested in this phenomenon. There's a lot of conversation about it. So you have this doctor that's talking about medical treatment. And, well, what she's offering is an alternative view of history. And her words caught a certain portion of the public.
Yes.
But the other section of the public, the media decided to say, oh, yeah, let's paint her off to be a crackpot. You know, I remember that's one of the attacks that they was very careful not to make on Minister Louis Farrakhan, who's over the Nation of Islam, who talks about UFO phenomena frequently, but they're very cautious not to attack him with being a UFO crazy. Okay, they're very cautious of how they do that. So so now they decided, well, this lady is espousing conspiracy theories or what have you. No, that's like, dude, how many Americans believe that John Kennedy wasn't shot by one gunman? Mm-hmm. You know, how many people believe that there's a conspiracy theory that had to deal with the death of Martin Luther King or with Malcolm X or multiplicity of other people? You know, hey, there's an alternative view of history that's out there that people are aware of, and this woman and talking about medicines that work with this disease happened to talk about something that isn't discussed in the mainstream media.
That's true.
Be it if you accept it or reject it, but don't paint her as being a crazy. But that's their power. That's their power to manipulate. That's their power to influence. Is that when they say that you're crazy, you must be crazy.
But she has, for those who would care to do their research, the woman is really not, well, in my opinion, she's not wrong, because if you look in the book of Genesis, you will have reference to the fallen angels. I know that you know the story.
Yeah, but you're not supposed to read that part of your Bible.
And
you're not allowed to talk about that part of your Bible because it hasn't been sanctioned by NBC, ABC, CBS, CNN, MSNBC, or Fox.
But if it were, and you did do the research, You would find that, particularly, and I think it's verse 6 of Genesis, it speaks about the fallen angels, and in the books of Apocrypha, and you know that word more than I do, there are three particular books that I particularly like, which is the Book of Enoch, number one, and there are three volumes of those. But in the first volume of the Book of Enoch, it gets into great detail about the war in heaven. Yes, I said it. There was a war in heaven where Lucifer was expelled from heaven along with the wind. But 200 of the alleged 200 of the
supporters,
rebel angels, and they came down to the earth. They were expelled to the earth.
And what did they do when they got here?
I think the word is they saw the women that were here.
Well,
And mated with them?
They had sex with them.
They had, okay.
They impregnated them, and they allegedly produced giants.
Which are called
the Nephilim.
Nephilim, uh-huh. And there are traces of that all throughout the world
One trip that I'm looking forward to taking in the future, and the world opens back up, is I want to go to Chile.
Okay.
And I want to have a behind the scenes tour of some special burial grounds there, just to, you know, it piques my interest. But
yes.
But that's another. Look, Mr. Bob, that's another show.
Yeah.
That's another topic. I'm glad to hear your amount of knowledge as it relates to that. That would make for a very tantalating conversation to talk about the, especially even the Bible and things that we aren't allowed to talk about.
Right. Okay. But now going back to that, when they did, they produced this race of people that were actually alien to what God had with man. They were called the Nephilim, and they were very bad and vicious people, so much so that they begin to eat everything, including other people.
Yeah, but we don't have to go to the Nephilim to look at bad and wicked people that have been produced that have eaten everything.
Yeah, Jeffrey Dahmer. Yeah, but anyway, but I only bring it up because this woman had made these statements, and of course, I will agree with you, the media just jumped all over that to put it in a different light.
Because and she wasn't standing alone.
No.
She was with her medical peers.
Yeah.
She was with her medical peers. But you know, the other thing they got upset with is how dare they have a press conference during the time period where John Lewis's body, his remains are being taken into the rotunda of the U.S. Capitol, and these doctors, and especially this black Negro female doctor, would hold a press conference during this sacred time in American history.
Okay, now what about this? And I'm just interested in your thought about this, Reverend Coach. Do you believe that America is a nation after that has two constitutions? Have you heard that?
Well, there was a constitutional change in for the people and by the people. That is a distinction that's within the U.S. Constitution.
And in and in 1781, I believe that has happened according to the research.
Yeah, but you have done what most black people should do. The Bible says to study to show thyself approved. Oh my God, I quoted scripture. I feel like my friend Dr. Frederick Lamar. But there's a the Bible says to study to show thyself approved.
Unto
God.
There you go.
That's right. We have an obligation to do the research and to study. And it's not hard and deep study.
No.
Look, I remember when we had to go to the library, Mr. Bobby. I said, now everything's available
at our fingertips
in order to... I mean, every major reference library in the world is available to you.
Except for Alexandria, which I would love to have gotten into that one. But I bring that up only because of a document, I believe it was the Act of 1781, in which before that, particularly concerning the Constitution, that the words of that were changed to the, it's all caps, which is, I understand, a legal term, the United States of America, the Constitution for the United States of America. Even on the money, it's all caps. And that meant something.
Yes.
And Go ahead.
Well, those are legitimate questions that we need to ask. Is there a difference between uppercase and lowercase letters, or things being in all uppercase letters? Does it imply any type of ownership or incorporation?
You
know,
yes.
We notice in this time period of COVID-19, when the whole Federal Reserve system has been changed. The Federal Reserve, the President of the Federal Reserve, the Chairman,
which is not federal, by the way,
right? Exactly, it's a privately owned bank that was established in Jekyll Island, Georgia. Yes, and I was on my way to Disney, and we were going to driving through the state of Georgia. And I saw the sign, Jekyll's Island, ahead. I'm like, what?
That made you think, yeah.
Oh, made me think. I pulled off.
I bring that up,
man,
because I remember.
I wanted to see it.
I bring that because I remember one show that you had here with, I think it was an attorney, Robert, I forgot his
last name. Owens.
Yeah, Robert Owens. And I remember you bringing that up, Jekyll Island. Well, you know me, I'm a researcher anyway. So I began to research that and found out some things that went on down there. Mm-hmm. And then the establishment, a private bank established with that name, the Federal Reserve, which is not federal.
No.
And then all the advantages went to businesses and the corporations and things like that.
It's private.
Okay. Oh, yeah, private bank. Okay. I asked that because back in 1781, that's when the U.S. became a corporation and not what we think it is under the a constitution. I'm using air quotes for those that are looking on TV. With the corporate interest, and Reverend Coates, one of the...
I know him, though.
Okay.
I knew him.
One of the persons that I found out that was a great benefit of that, because the war between England and the United States had ended supposedly with independence in 1776, but the states needed money.
Yep.
And one of the people, a very prominent family, that was there to issue that money to the newly formed
states,
was the Rothschild
family. Yes, and they remain present in our American history. Up to and including through the Civil War.
That's right.
Where their family financed both sides.
Would you say that again?
The Rothschild family financed both sides.
Yes, sir.
The North and the South.
Yes.
The Union and, and the Confederacy of the sides of the Civil War.
Okay, now, so because the U.S. is a corporation, and of course, if you would like to, you could look this information up, you know, as I did and still continually do, and I don't understand it all, but the U.S. is a corporation, and the President, Donald Trump, and I really hate to say this, but he's the President of this corporation,
yep,
of the United States. So you know what that means? That means, the way that I interpret it, listen, well, he doesn't really have to do what you want him to do, because he is the president of the corporation that makes money for the shareholders.
Absolutely.
Or the stockholders, which is one of the names that we mentioned. So he doesn't really have to do anything if he doesn't want to, because he represents those interests.
But what we see him doing is bringing about reform to this country and the way that it is economically structured. That's why we saw NAFTA torn apart, and we see the USMCA, new agreements, unilateral agreements. What's the difference between unilateral and a multilateral? Multilateral means that you bring more than one nation together in order to negotiate an economic trade agreement. A unilateral agreement means that we take those nations on one by one. One by one, the United States versus Mexico, the United States versus Canada, the United States versus whoever else we're dealing with, and negotiate with them independently in order to put together a contract that's in our own best interest, in America's best interest. That's why
you mean the corporation of America?
The corporation of America.
Okay.
That is why which affects all of us.
Yes.
Which affects all of us.
Because they're all intertwined.
All intertwined. And that's why the Trans-Pacific Partnership was a bad proposal, and that messed it took place, or it tried to be established under the Obama administration.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, we're on the same page as that. But that's a hard cold fact for some people to realize, that the United States is actually a corporation and not what you have been led very skillfully to believe that it is. That's who Donald Trump represents, period.
No, I think he represents people.
He
represents people because people need to go back to work again. And under his administration, we've watched the unemployment rate drop in this country significantly. And as we deal with black people, 1.4 million black people are now, and more black people are employed in the course of his administration. Our poverty levels have reached an historic low. You know, we look at the whole process of how the reform of the criminal justice system with the First Step Act is absolutely historic that they would reform the criminal justice system on the federal level, something that we have been advocating for a long time, not through executive order, but putting together and dragging the Democrats and the Republicans in Congress together to make law.
Let me ask you a question about that, a little sidetrack. You said the prison reform system?
The criminal justice
system. Yeah, criminal justice system. When I look at that, that's different from the prison industrial complex.
No, that's the same. But remember, our prison systems, or the whole jailing system in this country, is in three parts, really four, but it's really in three parts.
Okay.
So you have the state, you have county incarceration.
Okay.
And then you have state incarceration, and then you have federal incarceration. So you have local and state law, and then you have federal law.
Okay.
And what the president has authority over is federal law.
Yes.
So they went in to talk about the whole federal law. It was Bill and Hillary Clinton and Joe Biden, who Joe Biden is the granddaddy of mass incarceration, having written the three strikes you're out legislation that would put thousands upon thousands of black men in federal prison for the rest of their lives. Okay, this system needed to be reformed. It was around that same time period where people were talking about truth in sentencing and we need to clean our streets up. It's during that time period that Hillary Clinton called black men super predators that need to heal. You know, heal is what you say to a dog. You know, and that's the mindset that they have, and this is the system that needed to be reformed. So he helped to bring reform about in the First Step Act.
Yeah, as long as there was some money involved.
It shortens mandatory minimum sentences for nonviolent drug crimes.
So let me ask you this, Reverend Coach. Since we're right there, this whole thing. Now, you remember back in the late 60s, the movements that were going on. They think that some people think that Black Lives Movement, I'm not going to get on that right now, at least on this program, but this protesting and all this stuff, at that time it was the civil rights stuff that was going on. And I think one of the things that was born out of that was affirmative action. You remember all that?
Yes.
Okay. Well, and then I think for 12 or 13 years, it went on and blacks started to get different jobs, different programs. I call them programs of pacification, but because the same people, when the smoke all cleared, were still in charge. Look at your Congress and so forth. But to me, Reverend, and maybe I'm wrong, but the thing that really broke it and made the corporation come to the forefront in terms of legislation and the movement going their way was when Ronald Reagan broke the air traffic controllers strike. That, along with the Alan Bakke reverse discrimination, that was in 81 when this happened, when Reagan broke that. To me, and maybe I'm wrong, but to me, that's when corporate, most of the legislation, even up until now, banking regulations and so forth, have began to change in favor of corporate America and not you.
I wouldn't necessarily use the air traffic controller strike as an example of that. However, I do.
But union membership went down after that, of course,
but they were federal, essential federal employees. And I know as one that flies in the air, I appreciate it, the President Reagan using his executive authority to make those people go back to work in order to keep air travel safe.
Understand that.
But that also demonstrates the power of the executive.
Yes.
Okay. So all you people out there that like to engage in the oldest form of propaganda called name calling, that wants to call the President of the United States stupid and dumb and ignorant and all this stuff. Well, he's the executive, and the executive has a tremendous amount of power, yeah, as demonstrated by President Reagan.
Well, I brought that up because we just have a few minutes here. I brought that up about 3 minutes here. I brought that up because, like I said, and I just said to me, when I look at what happened in the Alan Bakke reverse discrimination case that just turned the floodgates around, coupled with what Reagan did with the air traffic controllers, not so much them going back to work and all that, but the busting of unions, not just that union, but unions all across America. Now, that set the bar or the standards that corporations or businesses used to do what they do now.
Yeah, but it also didn't save jobs.
No, it didn't.
It didn't save jobs because what happened is that the unions, I'm talking about from a union and a labor standpoint, the actions of especially the UAW,
wanted the
money that they were demanding for their workers were so high, along with the benefits. I mean, what's a good living on an hourly wage in this country? Is $30-$35 good? I mean, that's a good living with benefits. They were demanding, of course, much more than that, and that's when I think we start to see the shift of manufacturing begin to leave our nation.
Yes, I go say that.
Other places as well. Now, also during affirmative action, black businesses did not take full advantage of those programs.
This would be true.
Individuals got rich, but black companies rarely and reinvested into themselves in order to become larger and be able to eventually then bid on contracts as a lead
this
contractor.
This would be absolutely true.
They bought bigger houses and cars, but didn't buy backhoes and bulldozers.
Yeah, see, it's one thing to say you're for this or against it, but if you don't invest in your own communities and allow people or businesses to come in and run you, and then you want to argue, that's not going to be good. It's not going to be good for you, and now you're begging.
The black companies would hire all white employees.
Black companies would hire all white employees. Okay, we have about 2 minutes to go here. Reverend Chris, I really thank you for coming down and doing what you did. You want to leave us with some words of wisdom, and we have about a minute and a half before we have to close up the show. So what would you say? What would you have to say?
We have heard proverbially that this election is going to be the most important election of our lifetime. And I know we heard that presidential election after presidential election after presidential election. I believe that this election is going to be the most important election of our lifetime. America is in the grasp of socialists trying to shut our country down in the midst of Marxist protests and rioting and looting, in the midst of COVID-19, our whole government and economic system, we saw it shut down for multiple months, millions of people unemployed or what have you. We need to make sure that in this election that we vote for a presidential candidate and local candidates that have our best interest at heart. And I believe as far as a black men and women in this country, that Donald Trump has demonstrated to us through action that's where our best opportunity lies. What do we have to do? In fact, if you want more information about the Trump campaign, text WOKE, WOKE, to 88022.
All right.
Are you woke?
All right. Thank you, Reverend Coach, for coming down and helping us with the program. We went live today. This has been Talk Tainment Radio, the way it should be heard, Point West. And we'll be back at a later date. Thank you for listening, and hopefully next time we'll get some of your calls. Point West exclusively on TalkTainmentRadio.com, radio the way it should be heard. Thanks, you.